Welcome to In Conversation with the Grio. I'm April Ryan, and we are definitely pleased today to have Dr. Marcella Nunez-Smith with us, the incoming chair of a COVID-19 health equity task force for the Biden administration. You hear that? The Biden administration. So we have a vaccine. We have an incoming president-elect who is looking at infusing money into this economy and into the community that's hurting, $1.9 trillion, almost $2 trillion. There is an effort. This is the number one issue, everyone, for the Biden administration, because COVID is such a destroyer. But with that, we want to talk to Dr. Marcella Nunez-Smith about all of this. But in particular, it's interesting, on this King Day, we're talking to her before she gets her first vaccine. Dr. Nunez-Smith, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
You're getting your shot, as a lot of people of color who look like us, are like, I'm going to wait, or I don't know. Give us all that's on the table right now, because we have a history of problems within the medical community, disparity in treatment, but also our history with being the guinea pig, being the scientific experiment at our own peril. Is that playing into the fact that you're hearing a lot of Black healthcare workers are not wanting to take the vaccine right now?
Yeah, well, thank you so much for having me today and for, you know, this really important conversation. Because, you know, as you said, I'm an internal medicine physician. I'm very excited to go later today, King Day, and get my first dose. But there are many colleagues I'm hearing from, and the data show that not everybody who works in healthcare even is ready, right, to say yes to the vaccine. And then we know in the general public too, there are questions for all the reasons that you raised, which we have to acknowledge, because it's true. But I want us to do a little bit of a reset on this, because while we know that there's been experimentation historically, and let's be real, you know, the abuses and insults, we don't have to look too far back to find. But to put that over here and then say, what do we need as a community to keep ourselves, our families well? COVID-19 is devastating, you know, Black families, Black neighborhoods, Black communities. Who among us hasn't lost someone, really? Right? And so what do we have to do to get to the other side of the pandemic? You know, we have to ask the questions about the vaccine and the vaccination, but keep in mind that there isn't another exit ramp for us now. So here's what we know, right? The FDA has gone through a really rigorous process, importantly, without political interference. I think people need to know that, to take a look at the data that's come in from those pharmaceutical companies, right? There is good representation of, you know, people of color in those clinical trials. And we see that in the subgroup analyses, it's safe, right? And it is as efficacious. So that is really important news for us. And as we sit and say, like, yes, these are authorized vaccines, we're in an emergency. And I hear a lot of friends tell me, I don't want to be the first. And I was like, well, friend, you know, you're going to be the 3 millionth. And so we have so many people now who have taken the vaccine. I hope that begins to bring some level of reassurance and confidence to people who are waiting and watching. But I want to also say, I hear from a lot of people who are ready for the vaccine in our communities, and they want to know, where can I go to get it? They want to make sure that it's not going to be any out-of-pocket cost. And all of this is part of what President-elect Biden announced in a very ambitious American Rescue Fund, as you say, a legislative plan, $2 trillion. But we got to make sure that people who are ready, when you're ready for the vaccination, and it's your turn, that you can get it and you don't have to worry about cost or other structural barriers.
So I want to drill down on this vaccine. I was there when Vice President-elect Kamala Harris took her vaccine at the hospital in Southeast DC a few weeks ago. And it wasn't coincidence that she was in a Black community taking that vaccine. And she said that it was in efforts to spur confidence and to bring more people into this life-saving effort. Did you see a jump at all, or is it still like, let me wait and see?
We're making progress on this. I think people are gaining confidence, really, as they see people like Vice President-elect Harris get her vaccination, really as they see people in their own social networks get the vaccination. I think it is building. We are seeing movement on that. And, you know, for some people, it's going to take, you know, a little bit more time. And I think that's fine. We have to make sure that people have the information that they need to make the choice about vaccination. But it's just to underscore, I really say to folks who are worried about like long-term side effects from the vaccination, and I say, well, I'm really worried about short-term effects from COVID-19. And we have to keep that front and center. This is what we have. We're losing 4,000 people a day. I mean, the I can't even, the numbers, right? And so the vaccine is hope. But one thing, if I might say, we know that it's not just the vaccination, right? So I think that's another part of the conversation for people building confidence and rebuilding trust. So we should talk about that too.
So while I was at the event at the hospital in Southeast DC with Vice President-elect Kamala Harris, I asked a gentleman who was an asthma doctor, asthma and allergy doctor, about reactions, because we hear here and there about allergic reactions. And he said, look, he said, out of the 2 million cases that we had, this was at the very beginning, he said, there were only 4 allergic reactions. And I said, and he said, you know, that's good. He said, that was for, to include the trial as well as the emergency use authorization. And let's remind everyone, the trials are still going on. They're going to go on for at least 2 years. So everyone who's getting it, they're going to be tracking you as well, but you're not a part of the trial, but they're collecting data as well. So talk to us about the reactions. And I'm someone who has, because of my health issues, I have to wait and watch. Doctors have told me to wait. So talk to me about that. People who could have allergic reactions, or talk to me about the reactions to this. What should we expect if you have certain allergies to medicines?
Yeah, absolutely. It's a great question. And so, you know, everybody, as you have done, should talk to their provider about the specifics, you know, of your condition. But, you know, we hear a lot about people with allergies and autoimmune conditions in particular. You know, the CDC has weighed in and really says, when we're worried about allergies, it's for those people who have had an immediate severe reaction when getting a vaccine before or getting any kind of injectable medicine before. So somebody like me, I have asthma. You know, I live with food allergies, environmental allergies. You know, my son has it too. Like, you know, and that the CDC says, look, it's safe. It's safe. And so even if you have a family history of people with allergic reactions to medicine, that it's safe as well. And for a lot of times for the autoimmune condition, the consideration is really the medications you take. So sometimes it's just a matter of getting that timing right so that when you get your vaccine, your immune system can really mount the response we wanna see. So definitely everyone, you know, if you have questions, talk to your own provider about it. But the CDC has been really clear. It's just very, very, very few people who are at risk for these allergic reactions. And all around the world, people are getting these vaccines. So we have following data on millions, millions of people. I'm so glad you talked about that protocol for following everyone who gets that vaccine over time. So
important. Yeah, I talked to Pfizer about that. And, you know, it this is fast. You know, trials normally take years. And that's some of the reasons why medicines are so expensive, because all that cost is built into medicine, you know, for trials and research, et cetera. And, and Pfizer is the company that has the vaccine that is, what is the degree below zero?
Yeah, I know. It has to be kept pretty cool, right? We're looking at the minus 70 below zero. And that's real. Moderna, less so. But, you know, let me explain why that is. So the messenger RNA, people would have heard that term by now, that mRNA, and that's, there's not a whole lot in these vaccines. Let's be real about that too. You know, the vaccine has that mRNA in it. And then everything else there is about keeping that mRNA safe, right? And mRNA is pretty fragile, so that's why it needs kind of the bubble wrap, that's the other ingredients, and to be kept, you know, that cold. But, you know, it is a miracle, really, to have this technology. And people should know it is not new technology. The Obama administration put a lot of resources into this. It's been around for a long time. But it has implications for, you know, not everybody's doctor's office has a freezer that can hold Pfizer, right? And for us, thinking particularly about equity, again, for everybody in our communities who wants to get vaccinated, you know, we want to make sure that they can. So it's great that we have other options too. There is Moderna, you know, and they're promising vaccine candidates coming down the pike that may not require any freezer storage at all.
So, and as there is a push to get the vaccines, you have a push back. People want to sit and wait, or because of history, and that's one of the reasons why we're talking now, to inform you, to give you as much information as you can. But as we are sitting here, as you say, what is it, 4,000 people a day die from COVID. 4,000 people die a day from COVID. I know a lot of people who've been impacted by COVID, been sick, and I know people who have died, and it's hurt my heart. I know people who've lost jobs, lost homes, lost everything because of COVID. But now that we have a vaccine, there's now waste. Let's talk about that. There are doctors who are reaching out to people. We know that the elderly population is supposed to be the first to come in and get it, the most susceptible, the most vulnerable. But there are people not taking it. And I mean, I got a text from one of the organizations that I'm in, if you want to get the vaccine. I said, what? So talk to us about that. Just tell us about that, because I want you to tell it.
Yes. I mean, so the vaccines are a precious resource, and we don't have enough to waste. We just don't. And the way it works now is you have to sort of get a whole large number of them ready at one time. And if you don't use them, you'd have to throw them away. So what we see happening is, like, at the end of the day in some places, people are getting the texts that you're getting that are saying, we're going to have to throw them away if you don't come. And really, every person vaccinated is a positive thing and a plus. But we know, and President-elect Biden knows, that there's a lot that has to be done to get the vaccination campaign right. You know, 100 million shots in 100 days is the goal. And last night, President-elect Biden talked about his legislative plan to get the resources needed so that we can get ahead of this, make this process make sense. And later today, we'll be giving more details on that vaccination strategy. But you're right. So we're seeing sort of uneven uptake, right? And even kind of some uneven access in that process. Because whoever gets called at the end of the day is basically, you know, who people know to call. And we say, don't waste anything, but it would be much better for us to have this in an orderly process where the people who are most at risk certainly do get vaccinated first.
Yeah, so, and there's an effort once again to fund vaccines. What, tell me about that fund, the effort to fund it. And once he funds it, you know, he's funding it so we can take it. And right now the mindset is not, and he's not in office yet. The mindset, there's a concern that a lot of people are not. What are you going to do to get them to start buying into the vaccine?
Absolutely. So, you know, the legislative package is ambitious, almost $2 trillion, as you have said, you know, almost $200 billion, $160 billion to go to making sure that we have access to the vaccines and the vaccinations and a process that works. But we have to put as much energy, quite frankly, in getting this message out, right? It's important
because he said it was a dismal failure. He said last night, the vice president said this is a dismal failure in how the rollout of the vaccines. Yes. So what's going to be different?
Yes, absolutely. And later today, President-elect Biden is going to give a speech that goes into deep detail about the vaccination strategy to make sure that everybody has easy access. How do we work with states and territories and locals to bring all the resources of the federal government really to bear? And that has been missing. States and locals have been doing too much with really too little for far too long in this pandemic. And President-elect Biden, Vice President-elect Harris are committed to saying, look, the federal government can do more and can do better, and we will. And part of this has to be the communication that you're talking about. We know people trust particular folks to hear things from, right? And we have to make sure that those, you know, trusted messengers have all the information really that they need. And so that's a lot of my priority right now. So whether it's, you know, the nurse, the physician, the faith leader, others, right? How do we make sure that they have all their questions answered so that when people come to them, they don't need to say, you know, I don't know, nobody's told me, it's very confusing, right? That we have communicated clearly. There's so much misinformation out there. And that's what really worries me when people write and say, you know, can this thing change my DNA? can it make me infertile? And there's just no evidence of that, you know, at all. So we have to counter misinformation and also deliver clear, consistent, accurate information.
And lastly, two things. Are you looking for 80% vaccination rate in this nation? Or is it 70%, 75%? Which percentage rate are you looking for? And what's the time frame? And also mask wearing, because we're gonna still have to wear our mask for a long time.
Yeah, so very important. So, you know, what you're asking about is this herd immunity concept, right? Kind of how many people do you need vaccinated for there to be a threat? Look, I want everybody who can get vaccinated to be vaccinated. That is how we get safe. Because we know at the end of the day, it's about the people in your social community and your network. So if we have a national average of 80%, but in our neighborhoods and communities is 50%, it's just like nobody's been vaccinated. So I say, look, everybody who's eligible to get vaccinated, please get vaccinated. This is how we keep our families safe. So that's message number one. You know, this kind of question of, you know, what are we gonna be doing and focusing on in the administration from, you know, from the beginning, the president-elect is, again, just committing deeply to having the resources we need to think not just about vaccination, but about testing, you know, getting people access to the therapies. Black patients show up often too late. They've missed the window for the therapies, right? We have to do something about that. So this is important. And the masking. So, you know, the sort of last message is the masks have to be our friends, right? It's a shame this has become a political statement. This is what we have, and we know masks work. Even once we're vaccinated, we will continue to need to wear those masks. President-elect Biden has asked us to commit, right, for the next 100 days. Keep those masks on. Keep them over your nose, over your mouth. You know, please wear them properly. Make sure they fit. You know, if they're cloth, make sure you're washing them in hot water. And if you're living in a multi-generational home like I am, where there are people who are at high risk and you go out into the world, wear a mask inside too. We do in this household. So definitely the mask is, you know, we're going to embrace it. It's here to stay for a while. The vaccine and vaccination is going to make a big difference, a big difference. It is life-saving.
We need everyone, and not just here in the United States, it's a global thing.
It's a global thing.
It's kind of like what you're saying, the community. It's kind of, you can relate that to the world versus the United States. If we get it 80% and they only get, you know, 30 to 40 or 50%, we're in trouble. So it's a global effort. And we're in trouble. We have to start at home. And I'm going to say this, this is what my kit, we have got all sorts of household wipes and Clorox and all that stuff in the house. My kids and I go out with hand sanitizer or some kind of sanitizer in our purse if we touch anything, even outside. We have those contactless door openers. These are our kits, okay? We have gloves, we've got masks, we've got shields. We don't want it. Yeah. So we look crazy going out, but we're safe.
I love it. Thank you so much.
All right. Dr. Marcella Nunez-Smith, the incoming chair for the Biden administration of the COVID-19 Health Equity Task Force. And this is not going to be the first time you hear from her. We're going to have her continuously updating us. I'm putting that out in the atmosphere because I'm saying to you and to all of those in the Biden administration, we're going to make this happen. We're going to keep our conversation going because it's life or death. This is real.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, doctor. Thank
Have
you so much.
Day.